Hello everyone. Today we are going to study about immunopharmacology. This video series will be divided into two parts, wherein in this part we'll discuss basics of immunology on how the immune system actually works. So let's begin. So coming to introduction, the basic definition of immunity is: it is a particular ability of any organism to resist a particular infection or toxin by the action of specific antibodies or sensitized white blood cells. It is also the resistance that is acquired by the host towards an injury or infection by microorganisms and their toxic products. So what happens basically is, whenever the body encounters a bacteria or a virus or, for example, any foreign material, it sensitizes the immune response. So my immune cells produce antibodies, produce neutralizing chemicals, and ward off that infection. Immunity is also the protection against the infection, and it is only one of the consequences of the immune response, which depends purely on the reaction of the body against any foreign antigen. So the body will behave different and will produce different immune response to different kind of infections. Coming to types of immunity, we have innate immunity. In innate immunity, it is further subdivided into non-specific and specific immunity. The next type of immunity is adaptive or acquired immunity, which is again divided into active and passive. Both of these processes are subdivided to natural and artificial immunity. Now we come to innate immunity. Innate immunity is also known as native immunity. It is a specific kind of immunity that is present in an individual by birth, a resistance to an infection by the virtue of their genetic makeup. It is this factor that makes a specific race or demographical people susceptible towards a particular infection or immune towards it. So what happens is, as human races, we have divided into different races, different genetic makeup. So if one particular person in America shows resistance to a particular infection, the same may not be tell about the people living in Australia. So these two peoples differ in the genetic makeup, and hence they show different immune response. Innate immunity is not affected by any prior history of immunization or vaccination because it is already inherent. Innate immunity is further subdivided into two classes. We have specific, that is response which is specific to a particular type of antigen or a particular type of organism. Non-specific, it refers to in general ward off reaction to any kind of infection. Means it will not differentiate whether it is a bacterial infection or a viral infection. It will produce a non-specific innate response. Now, innate immunity is further divided into species, racial, and individual immunity. Now, what happens, as I already told about genetic makeup and all. So, in species, one species will show particular immune response to a particular antigen. Now, what does this mean? This means that if I consider a crocodile and I consider a human being, both of them have different genetic makeup, have different ancestral characteristics, so they will differ in their immune response. That is species immune response. Now, coming to racial, within humans, we see different kinds of races like whites, blacks, Africans, Caucasian species, etc. So, what happens is, one particular race will be at more risk or will be already immune to a particular kind of infections. That is, example here we have is, blacks in the USA are more prone to TB than the whites. This is because of their genetic makeup. Coming to individual, a particular individual may be immune to an infection. Now, this classical example is of COVID-19 virus. So the people who are asymptomatic are the ones who have already produced antibodies, but not all individuals are asymptomatic because their immunity differs. This is a classical example of individual immunity. Now I'll come to mechanisms of innate immunity. We'll discuss them in brief. First is epithelial surfaces. In that, we'll discuss skin first. Skin is a mechanical barrier to all the infectious organisms that encounter it. So skin is the largest human organ as well, as we all know. Skin is non-arguably the first line of defense or immunity against any infection. Various chemicals and bacterial flora on the skin makes it difficult for pathogens to enter or colonize onto the skin surfaces. So my skin has keratin protein. My skin is a mechanical barrier. My skin contains sebum. My skin contains some enzymes, some proteolytic enzymes that will cleave off a particular bacteria or a virus that comes into contact with the skin and tries to colonize on its surface. Also, apart from these factors, the pH of the skin also plays a major role in avoidance of bacterial colonization. The one that is marked in red is very important for GPAT and NIPAR examination point of view. So the pH of my skin is roughly slightly acidic side. It is 4.7 to 5.75. So not all bacteria are acidophilic bacteria. So what does this mean? This statement means that some bacteria require basic conditions or neutral conditions to grow on. Not all of my bacteria that cling onto my skin are acidophiles. So those bacteria may be ward off. Similar is the case with viruses, because viruses are also pH sensitive. Coming to the gastrointestinal tract, the saliva and the mucus that is present starting from the mouth itself till the intestines, the saliva or the mucus that is present in the esophagus prevents the adherence of microorganism, because if a microorganism will reside in a particular point, it will colonize, it will spread the infection, it will release its toxins. So saliva prevents all of these reactions. Also, certain proteolytic enzymes lyse the foreign cells that try to invest in human body. Acidic pH of the stomach also lyses the infectious materials that dodge all the defense system. So it may certain happen that my bacteria that comes in contact with my skin is okay with the environment. It may then travel to our mouth, because we touch our skin, then the bacteria will go through the mouth and it dodges that also. It dodges the esophageal barrier also. But the pH of our stomach is so acidic, it is sometimes less than even 1. So this very acidic pH is not favorable for any organism to sustain. The conjunctiva of the eye is also a type of, you know, mucosal surface. So whenever a bacteria or a foreign material enters the eye, our lacrimation is triggered. Now, lacrimation are basically tear droplets. So whenever as I poke my finger in my eye repeatedly, the conjunctiva triggers lacrimation process, and whatever foreign material that, you know, tries and resides in our eye is, you know, washed off with tears. It is actually flushed off, if I say. Besides lacrimation, tears also contain lysozyme enzyme that is very specific to bacterial cell, and it lyses the bacterial cell wall. So my bacteria cannot survive in my eye. Coming to respiratory mucosa, certain inhaled particles are also arrested by nasal mucosa because of its high density, its highly viscous nature. Also, Krupp reflex is also triggered as a type of defense mechanism. So whenever I eat something that is not favorable to my throat, or some organism makes its way through my throat, I cough. So what happens is, when I cough, I try to eliminate all these invading bacteria. That is body's innate response. Also, cilia is present in the inner lining of the respiratory system, and due to peristaltic movement, the cilia also wards off any kind of foreign pathogen. Next, coming to genitourinary tract. So it may sometimes happen that bacteria or viruses, you know, dodge all the systems of the body. It dodges all the previous factors that I have mentioned. So what happens? The ultimate fate of any material that enters our body is it gets excreted over a point of time, be it drugs, be it the things that we eat or drink. So some colony forming bacteria may find their way towards the urethral system. Because of the pH or certain enzymes that are present inevitably in my genitourinary tract, these neutralize the invading pathogens. Also, flushing action of urine contributes to the effect of warding off any kind of infection. It is also seen that the acidic pH of vagina, which is 3.8 to 4.5, also kills invading pathogens. So it is not limited only to female reproductive tract. My male reproductive tract also has certain antibacterial substances, because it is a known fact that male semen contains certain antibacterial substances too. So not only in the female urinary system, but also in the males, there are antibacterial defense mechanisms. Then my body will produce some inherent antibacterial substances. We will discuss that. These non-specific antibacterial substances are inevitably present in blood plasma. So these are very non-specific. It will have a broad range. It can kill wide ranges of bacterial substances. Whereas there are also specific components like proparidin, my complement system, which when gets activated, it neutralizes my foreign cells by poking in some portion of chemicals. Also lysozyme, as I have already discussed, and beta-lysine, which again is an antibacterial substance. Inflammation. Now, inflammation is a result of tissue injury or irritation caused due to entry of pathogens. Inflammation is accompanied by a wide variety of infections. Not only that sensitizes the immune system, but in general also. When a hard moving ball comes and hits me on my hand or my fist, it will produce inflammation and redness in that particular zone. Also, if a small mosquito comes and bites me, it will again produce redness and inflammation. Similarly, if any bacteria or virus invades this particular area, again it can inflame the particular zone. So we cannot say that it is a very significant parameter of immunity. That's why it is very non-significant. Due to inflammation, there is increased phagocytosis, there is dilution of toxic components because of increased vascular permeability, which is accompanied by inflammation process. So because of increased phagocytosis, my phagocytes or macrophages or white blood cells make their way towards the site of infection. So they'll produce immune response. Here in this figure, we can see what are the effects of inflammation. It causes vasodilation. This is the normal blood vessel lining, as we can see, very tight and compact. Whereas when it becomes inflamed, there is vasodilation and increased vascular permeability. So the substances that are present in my blood can ooze out. That is phagocytosis and dilution. Fever, again, it is very non-specific. So sometimes there is increased in body temperature, normally accompanied by infections. So it has particular sterilizing effect on bacteria only. It is not that it cannot kill viruses, but some viruses are temperature prone, whereas some can tolerate increased temperature. So it depends again. So fever, as I already told, it is normally accompanied by various types of infections. Now we'll discuss about adaptive immunity. So immunity that is developed by an individual during his or her lifetime by exposure of lot of infections and wide variety of infectious cells is called as adaptive immunity or acquired immunity. It is the second line of defense. So here is the flowchart, as we can see, acquired divided into active and passive. Now, active and passive, as I already discussed, is again subdivided into natural and artificial. In the coming slides, we'll discuss more on this aspect. So first we'll discuss natural adaptive immunity. In that we'll discuss active and passive. So active acquired immunity occurs when a person is exposed to live pathogens and foreign bodies. Likewise, it develops immunity against a particular invader or a specific invader. the performance is long lasting. Example is, we as individual go through a lot of infections in our lifetime. So because of this, performance is long lasting. Second is, passive acquired natural immunity is the translocation of active humoral immune cells from one individual to other in the form of custom made antibodies. Performance will depend until the development of one's own immune cells. So example is IgG and IgA from mother to fetus during pregnancy. We'll come to artificial adaptive immunity. Now, artificial means it is supplied from external source. So that is the definition out of it. So first is the active artificial adaptive immunity is immunization, where the microbe or parts of it are injected into a person and the person develops natural antibodies. The prime example is vaccines and sera. So vaccine contains a subunit of a bacterial cell or a viral cell. So when these foreign bodies attack my immune cells, the immune system gets activated. Hyperactivation leads to formation of my antibodies and certain chemicals that will make my body prepared in case a further infection occurs to that particular part of vaccine or sera. Now, passive is, it is through the serum therapy, the antibodies can be produced and then transferred to human bodies. Because of certain demerits, the humanized antibodies are produced in vitro by cell culture and are used instead, rather than producing it naturally from any animal source or human source. The prime example is monoclonal antibodies. Now, monoclonal antibodies have a wide variety of other applications as well. It is used in anti-immune response cells, wherein diseases like autoimmune disorders, whereas we consider certain drugs that are monoclonal antibodies. All the MAB, the drugs that contains MAB, rituximab, infliximab, all these drugs are monoclonal antibodies. Now here we can see a monoclonal antibody, which when gets attached to an antigen, it neutralizes the infected cell. Now, various kinds of cells are involved in my immunity process. First, the blood stem cells that are present in our bone marrow will differentiate into myeloid stem cells and lymphoid stem cells. Now, myeloid stem cell divides into red blood cells, platelets, and myeloblast. So, myeloblast is a link to produce granulocytes. Now, granulocytes include eosinophils, basophils, and neutrophils. Next, when we come to the right side of this figure, we have lymphoid stem cells, which mature into lymphoblast. My lymphoblast again de-differentiate into three other type of cells, that is B lymphocyte, T lymphocytes, and natural killer cells or NK cells. Together, granulocytes and lymphoblastic cells make up the white blood cells, which are chief cells that are involved in human immunity. Now we'll stick to lymphocytes, how they are produced and how they differentiate. First, we'll consider the cellular immunity on my left side. The lymphocytes may go to the thymus for maturation. In the thymus, they undergo maturation process and are processed into T lymphocytes. So they are stored for some time until an antigen comes and sensitizes it. So they become sensitized T cells. Now my sensitized T cells undergo de-differentiation process, produce cytotoxic cells, suppressor cells, and helper cells. Also, some are produced as memory T cells. Now, memory T cells are preserved for long use or for future infections. If I consider my right side, when lymphocytes go to the bone marrow or liver, they are processed again into B cells or B lymphocytes. Again, as of processed T lymphocytes, when an antigenic response, these are become sensitized B cells. Now, sensitized B cells differentiate into plasma cells and memory B cells. Now, memory B cells again have the same function as that of memory T cells. Plasma cells will produce antibodies and will contribute into my humoral immunity type. Okay, so these basically are two different types of immunity, which is cellular immunity, where all T cells are involved, and humoral immunity where B cells or plasma cells are involved. Now we'll discuss each and every cell. First, I'll discuss B cells. As I already mentioned, B cells are a part of humoral immune response. When B cells encounter foreign material or antigens, they respond by maturing into different cell types called as plasma cells. Plasma cells will further differentiate to produce antibodies. So, my antibodies are an extension of my plasma cells. Coming to T cells get their name T because they are developed from hematopoietic stem cells in the bone marrow, but they undergo maturation in thymus. So, T for thymus, T for T cells. You can remember like this for your exam. T cells often target viruses and are important in defense against viral type of infections. There are different types of T cells, killer T cells or cytotoxic T cells. These type of T cells perform the actual destruction of infected cells. There are other type of T cells called as the helper T cells, which indirectly is linked to my humoral response, which assists B cells to produce antibodies and assists my killer T cells in their attack on foreign substances like my antigenic material like viruses or bacteria. Next, we have natural killer cells or NK cells. NK cells, the characteristic is that it kills virus infected cells by injecting it with a killer portion of chemicals. So these chemicals are very specific antiviral substances that are inevitably produced in our human body. They are said to be natural killer cells as they do not require the same thymic education or same maturation process as their counterparts T cells require. So these are indirectly can be called as non-educated T cells, are an extension of T cells. NK cells are very important in defending against viruses, particularly varicella zoster, Epstein-Barr and the herpes simplex virus. And it is shown that some of the NK cells also have a role in preventing cancer, but the mechanism is not yet established. Coming to neutrophils, neutrophils or polymorphonucleocytes or PMNs as they are called are most numerous of all types of white blood cells, making up about half or more of the total. Okay, so what happens is neutrophils will increase their number or cause phagocytosis during an infection and are largely responsible for elevated white blood cell count, which are seen during certain infectious conditions. They are responsible for cell lysis and formation of pus. Now, because of increased phagocytosis, they cause lysis of infected cells. So my infected cells will release certain chemicals or certain materials which are already present in our body, and these prolonged deposition will form a white liquid thick, which is called as pus. Here in this video, we can see these green cells in numerous quantities are my neutrophils, and the red is the site of infection. So these quickly go and phagocytize the infectious site. Next, we have monocytes. These monocytes are very much related to neutrophils and are found circulating in the bloodstream. They make up roughly about 5 to 10% of the total white blood cell count. When monocytes leave the bloodstream and enter the tissues, they change their shape and size and become macrophages. So, maturation of monocytes lead to formation of my macrophages. Macrophages live longer than neutrophils and are important for slow growing or chronic type of infection. So neutrophils, as discussed, will quickly go to the site of infection and ward off the infection, that is short lived. But macrophages or monocytes have longer T half and are important for my slow going or chronic infections. Cytokines. Cytokines are very favorably called as hormones of my immune system. So these are very important set of proteins in the body, and these serve as hormones. Now cells of immune system connect or communicate directly because they are well connected next to each other, or sometimes communicate by releasing certain cytokines and act locally or at distant places. So suppose these two cells are at distant places. Now this cell releases cytokines, and cytokines go and sensitize this cell. So my cell, this cell becomes active, and it gets to know that an infection has occurred. Here, as you can see, a white blood cell which takes up antigenic material bursts and releases cytokines for communication. Now we'll discuss the chief part of immunity in brief, that is antibodies and its types. So the antibodies, as we all know, are secreted by T cells and natural component of the humoral response. Now coming to the structure, we'll discuss the structure in detail. The antibody is composed of two identical heavy chains and light chains bonded by a disulfide bridge. So this bridge holds together my heavy chains and light chains in a Y-shaped structure. So each chain is composed of structural domains called as immunoglobulin domains. Now each domain is composed of 70 to 110 different amino acid chains. Now difference in amino acid chains makes different type of antibodies, which will be discussed in later part of this video. Now this is the structure of an antibody, wherein in pink and red it is the light chain, in blue or dark blue color is the heavy chain. Also, because of the amino acid changes, one is the variable region and the other one is the constant region. So we need to know certain general definitions before coming. So epitope is a molecular region on the surface of antigen capable of eliciting an immune response and combining with specific antibody produced by such a response. So epitope is a region on my antigen which binds to my antibody and produces a response. Next definition is paratope. Paratope is present on the antibody surface, and it is a small region on the antibody's FAB region. Now FAB and FC portion we'll discuss in upcoming definitions. Affinity, it is the binding potential of a single variable region of an antibody to epitope or my molecular sites of antigen. Fab fragment, the antigen binding fragment is a region on an antibody that binds to specific antigen. FC fragment, or known as crystallizable fragment, is a molecule composed of constant regions of heavy chains and are responsible for binding to antibody receptors. We have discussed about constant and variable regions in the previous slide. Heptane are basically very small molecules. These are antigenic but do not elicit wide variety of immune response. So these are mild sensitizers of immune cells, we can say like that. Avidity, it is the binding strength of multivalent antibody to all corresponding epitopes of an antigen. So we'll know about this concept in the upcoming slide, that not all antibodies are a single fragment. They are dimers or polymers sometimes. So avidity comes into picture. Some general information about the antibody. There are five different types of heavy chains. These are alpha, gamma, epsilon, delta and mu. Each heavy chain has two regions, as already discussed, a variable region and a constant region. There are two types of light chains. One is the kappa and other one is the lambda. Each light chain has two regions again, one variable and one constant. The approximate length of the amino acid chain in the light chain is 211 to 217. This figure is important for GPAT and NIPER purposes. Also, there are five different types of immunoglobulins, as IgG antibody, IgA antibody, IgD antibody, IgM antibody and IgE antibody. Each of them differ in their molecular weight and the heavy chain composition. We'll see in the upcoming slides. Now, one by one, we'll discuss different type of antibodies. First is IgG antibody. IgG antibody makes up approximately 80% of the serum antibody content. It is the majority of my antibodies are IgG type. IgG is a monomer and has two epitope binding sites. The molecular weight is in the region of 154 kilodalton. The half-life is 7 to 23 days. So all my other antibodies will have a half-life of 2 to 3 days, but only IgG antibody has a half-life of 1 week to 3 weeks or 7 to 23 days as mentioned. There are four different subclasses in the ascending order of their quantities, mostly G1 in majority, followed by G2, then G3, and last or the least quantity of G4. This is the structure, a monomeric IgG antibody. Then coming to IgM antibody. Now, IgM antibody, one fun fact I would like to tell, which can come in certain qualifying exams, is IgM is that particular class of antibody that is very important in COVID. So my coronavirus will sensitize my immune cell and produce IgM antibodies, and IgM antibodies are responsible for neutralizing COVID disease. They are roughly 13%. It consists of the mu heavy chain, M for mu and M for IgM. So you can remember like this in exam. The molecular weight is 900 kilodaltons, means it is a very big molecule. It can exist as a pentamer, as I told you. It consists of a J chain which links all the monomeric units together. Now, this is the figure where you can see the mu heavy chains, light chain regions, and the J chain which binds all the monomeric units. Coming to IgA antibody, consists of alpha heavy chain, A and A, as I told you, remember this. It is 5 to 10% of the total antibody content in our body. The molecular weight is in the range of 160 to 320 kilodaltons. It exists as a monomer, dimer, or sometimes polymer. Present as secretory molecule in respiratory or mucosal epithelium. So remember, if a question comes in exam where IgA antibodies are present, you should know that it is a secretory type of molecule in respiratory and mucosal epithelium. So remember this for your exam. We can see the joining chain and the secretory protein fragment in the figure. Next is IgD, consists of the delta heavy chain. It exists as a monomer. It is very less concentrated and the quantities are as low as 1%. The molecular weight is 185 kilodaltons. It again acts as a monomeric unit and its structure is very similar to IgG antibody, but the amino acids are different. Hence, they are different. Last is the IgE antibody. It consists of the epsilon subunit. It also exists as monomer and the molecular weight is 190 kilodaltons. Next, the last part of this video is question and answer. So, the first question is, anaphylaxis reaction is due to which antibody? Option A, IgA. Option B, IgE. Option C, IgM. Or option D, IgG. So, my anaphylaxis reaction is due to B, IgE antibodies. So, always remember, wherever there is anaphylaxis reaction, there are four different types of anaphylaxis reaction. Okay. Anaphylaxis reaction, a very beautiful or representative image, if I can give you, of that reaction is the Jarisch-Herzschimmer reaction due to penicillin G. It causes redness and secondary syphilic type of reactions. So remember, it is due to IgE antibodies. Next question is, which antibody is responsible for the host to protect from bacteria and virus and provides passive immunity to fetus? So, while mentioning in slides, I have told you which is the only antibody which can cross the placental barrier. So the options are IgM, IgA, IgG and IgD. So the correct answer is C, IgG antibodies, because IgG antibodies are transferred from mother to fetus through the placental barrier. Next question is, which of the following antibody is a pentamer? A, IgG, B, IgM, C, IgA, or D, IgD. So IgG molecule is eliminated because it contains monomeric unit. Now IgA body, sometimes it acts as two different monomer units. IgD is also monomeric. So the correct option is B, IgM, which is pentameric, which contains J protein. Next question is, the serum concentration of which of the following human IgG subclass is maximum? A, IgG1, B, IgG2, C, IgG3, or D, IgG4. So the correct option is IgG1, and all of these are written in sequence, means IgG1 is highest, then comes IgG2, third is IgG3, and the least is IgG4. So remember this in exam. The last question for the day is, which component in the tears prevents bacterial colonization? The options are A, properidin, B, beta-lysin, C, lysozyme, or D, lacrimase. So the correct option is C, lysozyme, which is present in our tears and it cleaves off bacterial cell wall. Not to confuse with lacrimase, there is no certain enzyme called as lacrimase. So in exams, they might confuse you, because it is eye and tear, we tend to mark lacrimase. So don't make this mistake. Thank you. This is all we have for this video. And in the next video, we'll learn the pharmacology and how the drugs act. So goodbye. Thank you so much. We'll meet in the next video.